Last, let me talk about what real GDP tells us. So, one of the main reasons people watch GDP numbers so carefully is that short-run growth or short-run shrinkage of real GDP tell us some important things about what's happening in the economy. In the short run, we're going to see that higher GDP growth is going to create lower unemployment. And that is essentially because, remember, higher GDP growth means a higher level of total production. When firms are producing more, they want to hire more workers, and therefore unemployment goes down. Remember that GDP is not just production, it is also income. And both because people are sort of having more wages, and because generally there's more economic activity and profits are higher, and so on and so forth, higher GDP growth means higher, faster income growth. Because higher GDP growth tends to contribute towards a larger or faster profit growth, we're going to see that higher GDP growth is going to mean the stock market's going to go up. And then lastly, higher GDP growth is going to mean more tax revenue. So one of the reasons why the budget deficit for the US has shrunk over the last couple of years here in 2013 is that as the economy has recovered, the government has gotten more tax revenue. There are some reasons to care about GDP growth that are sort of purely material, that, we have higher production and more income and we like stuff. But I'd like to concentrate for the rest of this on some less obvious things. And a pretty persuasive argument can be made that countries that have higher economic growth are happier countries. Because essentially, when you have higher economic growth, you have a larger and expanding economic pie, and people don't become so worried about their particular share of it. Because if the pie is growing, everybody can have more. As opposed to a country where if there's no GDP growth, then the only way to get more pie is by taking some of someone else's pie. So we generally see, if we go out there and look, higher GDP growth is correlated with or tends to go along with sort of good things out there. People are more tolerant of minorities and more tolerant of immigrants, say, for instance. People are also more likely to have a higher amount of what we sometimes call social cohesion. So people will be more generous towards people who are poorer when there's a higher level of GDP growth, because people are sort of less concerned about preserving their own particular slice of pie, and more sort of willing to share, and they're more open-minded and more optimistic. The level of sort of public spiritedness and trust in government and that kind of stuff tends to be higher when GDP growth is higher and tends to be lower when GDP growth is lower. And just on some intangible level, higher GDP growth means a society where opportunities are available and people are more optimistic. Last, I'd like to go ahead and look at GDP versus three quality of life measures and the actual original data I've got over here in this Excel spreadsheet, and you can sort of look at some of the countries I used here and some of the values. One thing to notice here is just the enormous range in GDP per capita, GDP per person, so that we've corrected for population size around the world. And this is sort of a semi-arbitrary sample. I've tried to pick most of the world's biggest economies and also pick economies at sort of a wide range of different income levels that you might have heard of. So the US has a really pretty high level of GDP per capita. We're a pretty wealthy economy, even compared to other fully developed economies. So sort of all these countries here, Canada, Australia, Germany, Denmark, the United Kingdom, Japan, France, they're all definitely fully developed economies. But notice that their levels of GDP per person are about, 86% of the US's for Canada, down to about 72% of the US's for France. So again, all fully developed countries, but at significantly lower levels of GDP. Then I've sort of picked a bunch of middle-income countries here, and sort of notice that Mexico, in the global scheme of things, while its income per head is a little bit less than one-third of the US's, is actually still a relatively well-off country in the global scheme of things. Even if we're looking at countries that we might think of as really pretty poor, India, there are countries that are even poorer. I'd also like to point out that although people sort of think of China as being a wealthy country nowadays, GDP per head is actually still considerably below the US. It's still about one-fifth of what it is in the US. Now, of course, China has about four times as many people as the US, and its economy is growing rapidly. Its total GDP will probably get bigger than the US's sometime, certainly before the end of the decade of the 2010s, and maybe sometime around 2017 or something like that. But it'll be a long time before China catches up to the US on a per capita basis. And it may not ever. Certainly all of these countries here, including Japan, who everybody used to be sort of terrified of, have not surpassed the US. Norway here, it's worth mentioning, is sort of combines the best of both worlds. It's both sort of a fully developed economy with a well-functioning government and that kind of stuff, and it also happens to be sitting on top of large amounts of oil. So that's sort of the story on Norway. We go down and we see here that, even within Latin America, we're going to see here that there are going to be significant differences. Mexico is, and Argentina are very wealthy countries within Latin America. Countries like Brazil are significantly poorer than them. And a country like Bolivia or many of the countries of Central America, like Guatemala, are coming at about $5,000 of GDP per head. And these are what we call corrected for purchasing power parity. So it's true that, the cost of living is lower in Mexico, say for instance, than the United States. These statistics take that into account. India, has had a lot of economic growth recently, is not nearly as much as China's had, and is still just really a pretty darn poor country. And India is even, pretty wealthy compared to Pakistan. India is about 33% richer per head than Pakistan. And then, there are some countries out there that are really, I think, just unbelievably poor. And people are just really struggling to make ends meet. One way of looking at this is by looking at life expectancy. So this is life expectancy at birth in different countries. And you can see that for most developed countries, it's in the upper 70s or lower 80s. You can see that the US is an outlier here. We have significantly lower life expectancy than other countries with similar incomes, and lower life expectancy even than countries with, they're still developed countries, but significantly poorer. East Asian countries tend to perform fairly well. So China, a relatively unwealthy country, does pretty well. The countries of the former Soviet Union, or Eastern Bloc tend to not do so well. And some of these differences just have to do with lifestyle habits, that cultures are different and that sort of thing. Or people eat different amounts of red meat, say for instance, in East Asia than they do elsewhere. But broadly speaking, we can go ahead and look. I made a graph here. This series of red diamonds maps out the relationship between GDP and life expectancy. And what I've done here is I've set the country in the world with the highest life expectancy, Japan, I think, as one. And so we're comparing everybody to Japan. So if you have 0.8, your life expectancy is 80% of what it is in Japan. And you can see that there is some relationship here to between GDP, which is on this axis, and life expectancy, but it's not super strong. The sort of slope here is very gentle. Another one we might look at here is GDP versus homicides. That's GDP on this axis and these gray squares here. To look at the raw data, we can go back over here. This is homicides per 100,000 people per year. We can again see that the US is an outlier here. We have a pretty high homicide rate. Probably some of that has to do with easy availability of guns, but probably also some of it is purely cultural, because there are other countries out there where people are pretty well armed, and the homicide rates are still pretty low here. It's worth noticing that although the US is an outlier for homicide rates within developed countries, when we go down to countries at a lower level of economic development, many of them have much higher homicide rates. So, homicide rate for Mexico, probably no one will be surprised to learn, is very high given all the sort of drug war issues. Brazil, of course, is not at the center of the drug trafficking industry in the way Mexico is and still has a very high homicide rate. Russia, really high homicide rate. Or if we were to go out to Nigeria or Pakistan or that sort of thing, we would see countries out there having a really high homicide rate. We have really high homicide rates essentially in most underdeveloped countries because they don't have effective police forces. They're not rich enough to get enough people out of pure subsistence activities to have an effective police force. So when people have disputes, they settle them with violence instead of with the legal system. The last thing I want to look at here is in-migration. And these, I've indexed it to one, so I've compared everybody to Australia, which has the highest rate of in-migration, the most migrants per native in the population. And so the US, say for instance, has an in-migration rate which is 62% of Australia's, and so on and so forth here. Some countries, like Japan, essentially just don't allow our just don't allow immigration at all, full stop. So even though Japan is a wealthy country, and I'm sure many people would like to migrate there from, the Philippines or something like that, Japan just doesn't allow that. And of course, it's an island, so that means enforcing that's a lot easier. What we're generally going to see, if we go and look at this chart, the in-migrations are, excuse me, that's the homicides. So the homicides you can see here are these. I think I misspoke earlier. The homicides are the light brown triangles, and you can see that pretty clearly they're trending down here. The in-migration, it's a loose cloud, but these squares, you can see that pretty much people want to migrate out. There's negative in-migration from poor countries and positive in-migration from rich countries. And I think ultimately, when people talk about the relationship between GDP and quality of life, I think that's the most reliable thing to look at. People say a lot of things about how wonderful life is in a simpler era when we didn't live in big cities and we didn't have these complicated technologies and so on and so forth. But very, very few people really want to go out there and live in the Mexican countryside and try and make a living off 3 acres of land growing corn and beans, or really want to go out there and do, becoming a rice farmer in Vietnam or something like that. When people are sort of asked to vote with their feet and we judge people's true beliefs on the basis of their actions, people want to move from really poor countries to wealthy countries. Very few people want to move from wealthy countries to poor countries. And, all the romance of simple village life aside, I think that's really the ultimate test. People in poor countries either want their countries to become richer or they want to migrate to rich countries. And I think that's pretty unambiguous proof about the relationship between GDP and the quality of life.